For this video, we'll dive a little deeper in discussing and explaining the equilibrium systems of weak acids and a little bit more about their acid ionization constants, their equilibrium constants or Ka values. Again, a reminder that weak acids do not dissociate completely. They tend to be very reactant favored systems, and therefore they will set up equilibrium. So you'll notice with weak acid and weak base systems, we use equilibrium arrows. The equation that's shown on this slide is showing the general notation for a weak acid. So for example, if I were to give you formic acid as an example in a question, you might not know the formula of it, but you can use a generic equation such as this to recognize that there would be one proton that would come off of that acid to generate hydronium and, of course, our conjugate base. And any system that sets up equilibrium that will have equilibrium arrows, we can always write an equilibrium expression for. And again, we use a subscript on it to denote the type of system we're working with. So Ka denotes that we're working with a weak acid system. And of course, this expression would be our products over our reactants, raising everything to the exponent of its coefficient. And of course, we omit water because it is a pure liquid. The next thing to describe, and here's more detail about Ka values and what they tell us. The value of Ka essentially tells us how strong or weak a weak acid is, the relative strengths of them. So remember, with all equilibrium constants, the larger a constant is, the more product favored it is. And this is relative, so larger means it's more product favored. So even if we're dealing with small values, the larger a K value is, the more product favored that system is. Again, we're not saying it favors products, but it favors more products. Again, we get a larger value when we have a larger set of values in the numerator. And so Ka can be used as a way to gauge the relative strength of two acids. For example, in this table, we're told that we have 0.10 molar HF, 0.10 molar acetic acid. We see that HF has a Ka value of 10 to the minus 4, whereas acetic acid is 10 to the minus 5. Because HF has a larger Ka value, and realize here that technically the concentration doesn't matter. Concentration does not affect the value of Ka. That is independent of concentration. It is only dependent on temperature. So the larger a Ka value, the stronger an acid. And so to answer this question, it would be HF. To give you an idea of some values of acids, we of course have the acids and formulas and Ka values listed in this table. Again, K values are not ones that you need to memorize. They are just listed here for reference so you can get an idea of how large or how small they might be. They do go smaller than 10 to the minus 5, by the way. And notice the last column that's listed in here is a value of pKa. And this is nothing new. So at the top here, I have our formula for it. Remember that the little p in front of any notation means we're going to take the negative log of that notation or of that value. And so pKa is simply the negative log of our Ka value. And because we have the negative sign in here, realize that there is an inverse relationship between Ka and pKa. As Ka values go up, going up this column, our pKa values go down. So notice hydroiodic, one of our strong acids, has a value of 10 to the ninth per Ka and is a negative 9.3 for pKa. As we go down to acetic acid at the very bottom, 1.8 times 10 to the minus 5, and that has a value of 4.75, the largest value in this table. Another quantity that can help determine how strong or weak an acid is a quantity called the percent ionization. And this is a calculation that essentially tells us the degree of ionization or dissociation. And our equation for it would be calculated. Again, this is for acids. Our calculation would be how much hydronium concentration we get at equilibrium divided by our initial acid concentration multiplied by 100. Hopefully you recognize that this is the exact same calculation we use to check our assumption when we make when we assume that we have a small x. And so realize that this setup is exactly the same as what we used in our pH calculations earlier. So when we were determining whether we were within or less than 5% error, we were actually calculating percent ionizations. And so we did that in the context of this question. When we were asked to calculate the pH of 0.50 molar acetic acid, we calculated that the hydronium concentration was 0.003 molar. Now we're asked to calculate what is the percent ionization. So again, our setup for this would be our X value as a molarity divided by our initial acid concentration multiplied by 100. Because we are asked to do this one as a calculation, we are going to go to sig figs. So remember in our calculator, it only gave out 0.003, but I'm going to add a zero in here because for sig figs, that's what that value should have been. And so this would be a 0.60% for the ionization. The chart that's shown here in the right bottom corner of this slide is showing concentration on the x-axis. I just realized that that kind of got cut off. So these values are showing concentration. Here's our molarity and percent ionization on the y. And so essentially what this is showing is as we dilute a solution. So realize that we dilute a solution by, I'm going to go back to this slide. If I'm working with an acid solution, we dilute by adding water. If I were to add water to this solution, realize that Le Chatelier says that that would force my equilibrium to the right, and I essentially force more ionization. And so what this graph is showing is that as we dilute, or we are lowering our concentration, adding water to it, we are in fact slowly increasing until it becomes very dramatic. We are increasing our percent ionization. This table is just showing numbers to illustrate this effective dilution on percent dissociation, not numbers that you need to memorize. But in our first table, we're just looking at acetic acid. At the very top row, we're showing concentrations. And of course, we are diluting as we add to the, or as we move to the right. And notice we are calculating the concentration of hydronium in the second row. So although our degree of ionization, the percent ionization will increase as we dilute, notice that we are technically producing less and less hydronium, right? With this low a concentration of acid, I have to produce less hydronium at equilibrium. And of course, as our concentration of hydronium goes down, our pH goes up. So we have an inverse relationship there. The second table is showing the same thing, but now we're comparing HCl to acetic acid. So notice we're diluting each one as we move to the right, indicating how the pH changes, and in the bottom row, the change in degree of ionization. Realize that the hundreds for HCl are all theoretical. In the real world, we would see a difference with a strong acid once we dilute. And for acetic acid, of course, we do see an increase in the percent ionization as we dilute. This slide is here, as it says in the label, to point out trends. First, looking at the relationship between hydronium and pH, we of course have an inverse relationship here. So as hydronium concentrations go up, because we have a negative sign in this equation, our pH values go down. And that's very helpful to keep in mind as you're either comparing different concentrations of an acid or different concentrations of hydronium among two different acids. You can actually evaluate that the pH values make sense. as we change the strength of an acid. So if I increase the strength of an acid, a stronger acid, we want to know what is going to happen to Ka values, and those should increase. So as we get stronger and stronger acids, we get larger and larger K values. The last relationship we've already mentioned, very similar to the first one up there, that we're comparing Ka values to pKa. So as I change acids and the value of Ka increases, again, because of this negative sign in this equation, our pKa value decreases. pKa is important to keep in mind. We don't focus on it a lot in here in this class, but if you're going on to organic chemistry, that is the quantity that organic chemists use to identify the relative strength of acids. And so remember, from their perspective, the lower the pKa, the stronger the acid.